Greetings, fellow nerds. This week there is very little sodium work as I'm waiting for more chemicals to arrive in the mail. I also landed a new job. So things have been hectic as I settle in, so my videos are going to come out less often, but once I have a good routine going, I should be returning to normal video production. Now in other channel news, I have received another community guideline strike on my channel. This time against my synthesis of sodium cyanide video. And to be honest, this is the first strike I actually accept. Now I personally think the educational value outweighs the danger, but I can see it from their point of view why they wouldn't like it, and removing it isn't contradictory to the policies of YouTube. Nor is it excessively broad like when they took down my synthesis of the anti-malarial drug pyrimethamine. So I'm not going to fight this particular strike. I suppose after indiscriminately taking down so many videos, they had to find a valid one eventually. But since my channel is closer to being banned, I do hope I last long enough to produce my last great project, the sodium synthesis. Now as said before, I'm still working hard on it and progress has been steady. In particular, I'm trying to get more catalysts for my sodium experiments. Buying them through the mail is one option, but as I wait, I want to try making some. Now one catalyst candidate that's been suggested to me a lot is something called terpin hydrate. It's based off 4-terpineol and is actually the product of hydrating the double bond. The original alcohol group undergoes a migration by passing through an alkene intermediate. What we essentially get is two tertiary alcohols on one molecule. Now I'm not sure if this would do us any good and it might make the resulting alkoxide too poor to be soluble, but we might as well give it a shot. Now I looked for literature on how to make it and it seems simple enough. Mix a source of terpenes like tea tree oil or turpentine with eleutherfuric acid and stir for a prolonged period. So I did that. I mixed about 200 milliliters of tea tree oil along with 200 milliliters of water and added 30 grams of sulfuric acid and then stirred. The literature says this should yield a precipitate of terpin hydrate overnight. Then I stirred for about 3 days and at the end of it, nothing happened. I then left the mixture in the back of my fume hood for 3 weeks and finally a tiny clouding of stuff seems to be coming out. It's not very much though, I'm not even sure if we could recover that. Now some literature sources suggest high concentrations of acid, so I tried again with 50 milliliters of tea tree oil, 20 milliliters of water, and 50 grams of sulfuric acid. Looks like we're getting some reaction, but even after a few days I wasn't seeing anything solid. At this point, I kind of abandoned this line of inquiry. Not because it can't work, I'm sure I'm probably doing something wrong, but I think my efforts are best spent on more promising avenues like finding an off-the-shelf catalyst. I may yet revisit terpin hydrate as a catalyst if everything else doesn't pan out. I'm still leaving this flask in the back of the fume hood in hopes the reaction continues. Anyway, as found in previous lab note videos, 4-terpineol from tea tree oil was found to be a workable catalyst, but decomposes with time, so a large starting amount is necessary. 4-terpineol also needs to be isolated from tea tree oil by fractional distillation, which is not all that easy at the temperatures required. Now a way to solve both problems is to hydrogenate tea tree oil. This is already well-known chemistry. Basically add hydrogen to the double bond and hopefully make the resulting alcohol resistant to decomposition. This would also make all olefinic impurities aliphatic, which should be as inert as the mineral oil as we're using to run our reactions. Unfortunately, this does not happen by itself. If you feed hydrogen into alkene, nothing happens. So we need a catalyst. The most common catalyst in the laboratory is palladium on carbon. It's the most active, even more active than platinum, and so effective that almost every professional lab doing hydrogenations has some. If you want to actually see palladium on carbon being used for hydrogenation, then I recommend checking out Applied Science or Nile Red. Both of these channels perform hydrogenation of vegetable oil to make margarine. They're excellent videos and I've linked them in the video description. Now palladium on carbon is within the abilities of the amateur to make, but like making tertiary alcohols, it's a rather involved process and you also need to buy palladium. The effectiveness makes it cheap since you can use very little, but the initial cost might be prohibitive. So to make my hydrogenations more amateur friendly, I decided to try and make another catalyst called Urushibara nickel. It's not as effective as palladium, but the required chemicals aren't too hard to get. First, I had to make nickel chloride. Nickel chloride can be purchased online, but nickel metal itself is often easier to get. You can even hack it out of nickel metal hydride batteries and it'll work. So to convert nickel metal to nickel chloride, I added it to hydrochloric acid. But nickel reacts very slowly at room temperature, so to speed it up it needs to be boiled. Eventually this forms nickel chloride. I made a lot of it since I want to do other experiments with nickel and I don't have nickel chloride as a stock reagent. I then boiled it dry and eventually obtained nickel chloride. Now making a Urushibara nickel precursor isn't that hard. Zinc powder is obtained and a 1/10 mass equivalent of nickel metal is weighed out in the form of a nickel salt, like our nickel chloride from earlier. We then add water to both and heat them up until they boil. From what I read in the literature, the more vigorous the reaction, the better the resulting catalyst, and that's why we're boiling everything. Now looking back at this point, I think I screwed up. If you look over at the zinc, it seems to be rather pasty. I don't think that's zinc. I think that's more zinc oxide. The zinc powder I was using must have oxidized over the years to zinc oxide. What I should have done before I started was wash the zinc with dilute sulfuric acid. Zinc oxide easily dissolves in sulfuric acid, but zinc metal actually dissolves very slowly because it has a high hydrogen overpotential. Unfortunately, I didn't think of that in time, so I went on to the next step. Mixing the boiling nickel chloride solution directly to the boiling zinc paste. Now this extremely vigorous reaction is actually perfectly normal. We're getting a very exothermic metal displacement reaction with the nickel depositing very fine particles onto the zinc. It's so exothermic that it's boiling the mixture further. So my crappy zinc still has enough good zinc in it to make this reaction work. Although I still think I would have been better off using good zinc. Anyway, looking back, I should have also used a bigger flask to contain the reaction. Luckily, I had the foresight to install a splash arrestor onto the flask before I started to deal with exactly this sort of occurrence. As you can see, I definitely got my money's worth there. Anyway, I let the reaction continue until it stops. Next, we filter our mixture to get our precursor. Be sure to wash it with lots of water, and finally with some methanol to get rid of all the leftover salts. And here it is after drying. Yeah, I really think I have way too much zinc oxide. Hopefully I get some activity out of this, but if I don't, I know what to fix. Anyway, this is the Urushibara nickel precursor. Basically, it's ultra-fine nickel deposited on zinc particles. In this form it's stable indefinitely, but not directly usable. To make it usable for hydrogenation, it's reacted with a strong base or weak acid to destroy the remaining zinc and release the nickel particles. Then those particles are filtered and used for hydrogenation. But that's best done just before you actually do perform your hydrogenation. The activated nickel loses activity as it's exposed to air. So it's best kept in this precursor state when you're not using it. Anyway, I'm still preparing for hydrogenation, so I'll get to that eventually. But as you can see, overall, the process of making the catalyst doesn't seem to be that hard. If this works, I'll make a proper video with masses and variables. And if not, I'll try again. Now I've been running a concurrent sodium experiment where I ran with an excess stoichiometric ratio of sodium hydroxide to magnesium. If you recall, I already ran this test a while back to see if we could avoid using dioxane by making sodium without magnesium contamination. We found it was very difficult to finish since the reaction just kept getting slower and slower, and even after 3 days it never finished. Well, I decided to revisit that experiment since I had more time now, and this time I used a huge amount of sodium hydroxide. Almost twice as much and ran for several days. Finally, the reaction flipped over and all the magnesium was consumed, but something interesting happened. The sodium broke up into a very fine dispersion. You can see it here almost like sand. Let me see if I can get closer and get a macro shot. And there we go. It's clearly a spherical metal, so it's not the original magnesium just worn down. When I poured it out, most of the slurry passed through the sieve and whatever did collect was very little. So it seems like a little bit of magnesium is needed to keep the sodium metal together in large globules. I actually noticed this effect very early in my experimentation, but I wasn't certain it was due to excess sodium hydroxide, as I was also dealing with glassware destruction at the time. So I had to consider the possibility it was a glassware contamination problem. But now it looks like it really is an effect of using excess sodium and letting the magnesium be consumed. Now you might be wondering, how does magnesium prevent the sodium from breaking up? What I think is happening is the magnesium is imparting a negative charge to the sodium as the magnesium is oxidized by the reaction conditions. This charge alters the surface tension of the sodium and either allows the sodium to easily coalesce with other droplets of sodium, or makes it harder for the sodium to detach and break up. Perhaps both effects are at work. We've actually seen a very similar effect way back in the gallium beating heart experiments. In those experiments, the gallium metal changes its surface chemistry in a sulfuric acid solution whenever it's left on its own or when it touches an iron wire. In this case, we have sodium metal for gallium metal and magnesium metal for iron. Bottom line, in order for us to get great sodium coalescence under these reaction conditions, we need a small amount of magnesium to maintain the right surface charge on the sodium. So it looks like we'll always need to run with excess magnesium. First, because the reaction becomes terribly slow if we don't. And second, and perhaps the more important reason, because the magnesium maintains sodium cohesion. You might be thinking that we can use dioxane to recover the sodium droplets from this slurry. While that might be possible, it only underscores the continued need for dioxane. If we're going to keep using dioxane, then we might as well keep with our current methods of using dioxane to separate sodium from magnesium metal. You know, looking back, I remember lots of amateurs running with excess sodium or potassium hydroxides when they were doing their experiments since magnesium was the more expensive reagent. Perhaps a lot of their reaction failures weren't failures at all, but simply a loss of product because it was this fine dispersion. They did report that the resulting slurry was exceptionally reactive, but couldn't collect any large pieces of sodium or potassium metal. Now that we know product cohesion is dependent on excess magnesium, this might offer an explanation. So you amateurs that were working on this research years ago and kept failing but got highly reactive slurries, perhaps you did succeed and didn't know it. So that's what I've been up to for now as I wait for more chemicals to arrive. Hopefully they'll get here soon and I can start testing. But if not, I'll get to work on hydrogenation of tea tree oil. Thanks for watching. At this point, I'd like to thank my Patreon supporters. I would never have bothered to research anything this thoroughly or produce lab notes without your approval. It's because of you that we have come this far. Thanks.